you can read faster than I can talk. I will probably go through them fairly quickly. Stuart is a hard taskmaster and wants to make sure that we leave time left at the end. My bottom line is very easy to explain. In this country, in the policy world, we spend a lot of time talking about policy, what we'd like to see in the way of changes. We spend also a lot of time evaluating what the results of government actions have been, but we don't spend, in my view, enough time talking about the keystone in the middle, which is the choice and the design of the tools of government. So I will come back to this question of the tools, and we shall see if I can get this orientated, as they say in the Pentagon, correctly. Ah, an old example speaking to the resources necessary to get government accomplishing what it's supposed to was what some friends and I used to call Phase 4 Souvlaki. There were wage and price controls in the Nixon administration, but the Souvlaki kept getting smaller. But how many people would it have taken, how many inspectors, to have measured the quantity of the souvlaki as opposed to the wage and prices of it? Another example was during Prohibition. Al Capone controlled the entire bootlegging business all the way from Canada to Florida. He had 10,000 speakeasies in Chicago alone, but there were never more than 1,520 federal prohibition agents. As we used to say in Boston, you can't get there from here. Now, there are new examples also. In 2013, a fertilizer plant exploded, killing 14. The plant had not been fully inspected for over 30 years. OSHA, which does that, and its state partners had only 2,200 inspectors to protect 130 million workers in 8 million workplaces. Kind of a challenge. Another one, which is slightly sideways, is that NHTSA, the Department of Transportation, had $134 million in 2013 to address 34,000 traffic fatalities. This was less than what we spent protecting the U.S. Embassy in Iraq for 3 months of that same year. So there's a question of priorities. And another, the IRS budget for 2014 was 7% lower than in 2010. The IRS lost 10,000 staff members, 11% reduction. And for every dollar spent on IRS enforcement, an estimated $200 in unpaid taxes is recovered. So there's something non-functional about that system as it's working. Now, there's one good example, which I got from my time working with the Innovations Program at the Kennedy School, is that Social Security has only had 10 attorneys working on Social Security fraud since 1988. But in 2011, they were swamped by internet fraud problems. And instead of proceeding case by case, which they've been doing since 88, they partnered with Google, Apple, Microsoft, Facebook, banks, the whole kit and caboodle, to block both ads and payments. Thus, they prevented most internet fraud with Social Security before it began. That's a change in the regulatory process. That's a change in the way of doing business. That's a change in the design of government itself. And the paradox is, and these numbers most people don't pay attention to, but since the 60s, U.S. population has gone up by 67%, private sector workforce by 136%, size of the federal workforce has gone up by 10%. Now, there are a lot of contractors. No one can come up with quite the number of contractors, but still, that shows that we don't have the resources that we once did in terms of the application of individuals to problems. And many of the world's challenges today are more complex, critical, and urgent than ever. At the Department of Defense, they talk about VUCA. I don't know if you all are familiar with the term VUCA, but you can look that up. It's some combination of volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. So, given the decline in resources and given the increase in the problems which the society wants to get solved, how do we get there from here? So I say we need three things. One is a better understanding of the challenges we face, and we often talk about unintended consequences, and since Jay Forrester died last month, I do want to mention counterintuitive behavior of systems. Sometimes we push on a system and the system pushes back. And there's quite literature behind that, his book, World Dynamics, Urban Dynamics, so forth. And I think we need a broader set of policy tools for tackling those problems once they're better understood. And I think we need evaluation of the effectiveness of the tools themselves, not just, quote, program evaluation. How did that tool work in this circumstance, with a focus on the results, but feedback to the tool selection and modification process, which is a different thing. We don't tend to evaluate the tools, we evaluate the programs. And those three things, first, understanding the challenges. We need to deploy all the disciplines we can. System dynamics, bad words, cybernetics, people don't talk about that for the last 30 years, but it's all part of this, part of the problem. We need to introduce, I would like to introduce, legislative impact statements. The Congress put that onto EPA for environmental impact statements years and years ago. But I've never seen much in the way of the Congress saying with specifics what they expected this piece of legislation to accomplish. And if you had that, then people could look at that, or you could come back and check them on that later. So I would like to see legislative impact statements. And then, of course, in this age of the internet and everybody being interested in these problems, I'd like to go to crowdsourcing, both for problem identification and analysis and to search out new policy tools and uses. I think you all know what crowdsourcing is, but I put it in there anyway, asking everybody, particularly in the age of the internet, hey, are you interested in this problem? Have you got some thoughts? Let's get together, at least electronically. Crowdsourcing is not new. The Longitude Prize in 1714, when the British government was trying to find a way to come up with measuring longitude, they said they'd pay a prize to somebody who came up with that. So, and I think that's crowdsourcing. And we need the broader tool set. This is the second of my three things we need. One, we have the standard tools of government, but they have enormous variations in the resources needed for complete implementation and also in effectiveness. We have newer tools, such as prizes and nudges, which emphasize simplification, and we need more tools. There's no way to say that we have a complete set of tools, that all the tools have been invented. Nope, we're not going there. Now, this is the standard tool chest, and this is taken, these are the chapter headings of a book, The Tools of Government, by Lester Salomon, who teaches at Johns Hopkins. I taught the second section of his course for 2 years, back when they had a bulge in the student population. So I've taught each and every one of these, and that's the standard set. An example of how one of those could be used or could be changed is the Mine Safety and Health Administration, which had in FY11, they had $350 million and 2,400 people, and I think they're down to 1,000. I saw something on the web, but that may not be true. A company called Massey Energy grossed $2.3 billion in 2009. And MSHA, as it's called, had proposed fines of over $10,000 for only 25 of Massey's 1,300 violations over 5 years. Not much of a disincentive. Now, if you changed from that which is economic regulation on the list to tort liability on the list of tools, and you impose that legislatively on Massey and the other coal miners, that, hey, you have to pay $10 million for every miner that dies underground, or however you define it, Massey would probably buy insurance. The insurance company would then have skin in the game, and they would insist on and probably monitor for the best safety practices. That's the same sort of tool change that, in a way, that Social Security did. You would not need $350 million or 2,400 people. Now, if you don't like that tool opportunity, there are probably some other ones. And there are obviously difficulties with that, and you can't apply tort liability to all areas. Cass Sunstein has written a couple books, one called Nudges, another one called Simpler Government. And he talks about nudging people's behavior. And he does admit that that's sort of a form of libertarian paternalism. You're sort of encouraging people to do this. You're not forcing them to do it, but you are nudging them to do it. And you do that by providing choice architecture so that the easy choice is to do what you want them to, so forth and so on. This is like the candy bars by the checkout at the supermarket, right? That's why they're there. That's the choice architecture. There are, for example, default healthcare and savings options. If you go to work someplace, in a lot of cases, if you don't change it, you're automatically contributing to a 401k and you're automatically choosing a health system. And so if you don't want to do that, you have to say, no, hey, I don't want to do that. But if you don't say that, then you've got a savings program. We're seeing a lot of calories count on menus these days, which I find sad, but there it is. In some cases, people are now getting, in effect, an automatic tax return. In the past, they've had a simple tax return, and it's this much for expenses and this much for salary. Then they get something which they could then just sign and send in. That works pretty well. Smart electric meters, so that you get some more immediate view of how much electricity you're burning, and you can say, oh no, let's make sure we turn the lights off. Do we really need the thermostat to be up to 70 degrees overnight? And then with the smart meters, you can see how much you're saving, and you save money, and we also save energy on that. The most novel one of those that I've seen recently is the dollar a day programs, where if a young woman, unmarried in her teens, has a baby, then some governments will pay her $1 a day for every day she's not pregnant. And that provides an incentive on her part. And the Lord knows that's got to be safe, got to be cheaper, safer for her, so forth and so on, for everyone. And that's a nudge. She don't have to take it. Options are still there. And then I've got a couple of my favorite quotes. Congress never gets anything right the first time. After 5 or 6 years, we have to revisit our solutions and correct them. This is one of the problems with Obamacare, without any willingness on the part of the Congress to go back and fiddle with the stuff that didn't quite work the way we hoped it would work, which is true of all legislation, then that becomes a problem. I think Bradham has had enough experience to back up that quote. And then one of my favorite engineers is Henry Petrosky, who talks about failure. If we only focus on success and not on failure, we're likely to have more failure. Failure is an unacceptable difference, but anticipating and identifying how a design can fail or even be perceived to fail is the first step in making it a success. So studying failure is very important, and I don't think we do enough of that. Madeleine Albright says, people are speaking to their government with 21st century technology, a la crowdsourcing. We're listening with 20th century and responding with 19th century policy. We need more choices. We need more people involved in coming up with the choices. Now, if you want to dive deep into this stuff, which we won't do right now, one of my favorite authors, Donella Meadows, came up with the places to intervene in a system. And what we're talking about here is how do we intervene in an existing system of a civilization in such a way that you come up with a different outcome. We don't have the time or the energy, certainly, to talk about these in any depth, but it does show that there's a wide range of places that are open to discussion. And last but not least, Charles Darwin said, it's not the strongest or the most intelligent who will survive, but those who can best manage change. And if DOD calls it VUCA, or if we just call it complexity, et cetera, then I think we're in the midst of a lot of change. And so I think we need to be focusing again on what is the nature of the instruments that government can use to try to affect whatever changes people would like to do. I come to this, as Stuart said, with too much experience in the federal government. Those are the places I worked. I became, for those who of a certain age, I became a GS-16 at Commerce, where I started an Office of Program Evaluation years ago under Elliot Richardson in his time. And that's my website. And this is an area of intense interest to me. It has been the design of government since the 70s. And so I'm asking for crowdsourcing. Anybody that would like to come and get into a discussion, there's my email address. Stuart? Elephant?
With the mechanism here.
Right.
And you have a lot of experience. I have 40 years at GAO. I think I know what I'm talking about. It's political ideology.
Right.
Today, we have a new administration coming in that doesn't believe in government. That believes in deregulation. So you're looking at a model here that is kind of a rational model, but the environment we live in is not rational. So how do you balance that?
I have been very careful in this discussion to try to keep politics out of the discussion of policy. If you and I could get together for lunch sometime, we could continue that discussion. But I am making the rebuttable assumption that rationality in attempting to change outcomes in society is one of the tasks of government. I like the Social Security Administration example, but one of the questions is the academic community has had a tendency to, well, I could talk about the fact that on the East Coast we talk about stovepipes, in the West Coast we talk about stovepipes, in the middle of the country we talk about silos. We can't even agree on the same intellectual problem across one country, 3,000 miles. But I would like to see more input back into the government to try to talk about some of these options. I don't think that the Congressional Budget Office does much of it. I wish I'd worked at GAO. That's one of the places I missed. I don't know how I did it. But we used to have, and this is as close as I'll get to politics, we used to have a number of institutions on Capitol Hill which took a broader approach to intellectual life. The Office of Technology Assessment comes to mind, a number of committees, so forth and so on. We don't seem to have those, so that would be a good place to start. But my presumption, which is not an assumption, it's a presumption, is that a rational approach can have results over time. Sure. First of all, if you look up counterintuitive behaviors, I believe, on the internet, the wonderful internet, you'll find an article which is chapter 6 in Jay Forrester's book, Urban Dynamics, which explains it in detail. But what he is saying in a too short a sentence is that if you have complex systems, he was talking primarily about complex social and economic systems, and you attempt to change them by pushing through one of these tools, the system will often react by pushing back, trying to maintain its stability. I'm not coming up with a good example, but he was talking again about urban dynamics, about how cities work, how housings in cities work, as well as international economics. Stuart, can you amplify that?
A very common example of it is congestion, and so you widen the road. And as soon as you do that, it becomes more desirable. And so apartment buildings and shopping centers are built along the road, and then all of a sudden you've got congestion again. So it's not a stable system that you're dealing with. Real estate investors, you know, somebody builds a highway and you look for an intersection and you put a hotel there. So you just have to think about who are the stakeholders, who are the people involved, what are their goals, how are they going to react to things, and take that into account. You don't just say, oh, it's congested, we need to widen the road. That's an overly simple approach.
just to build on that point, Riddle and Weber, you read them, characterize these as wicked problems as opposed to tame problems, because you're not controlling all the variables. You think you can run an algorithm, but as complex as the algorithm is, and it bounces back on you.
Butch, why don't you carry on?
Okay.
Our next speaker is Butch Bosin. He is also an experienced federal government manager who has worked at a variety of agencies.
How do I click this thing?
Forward. Food and Drug Administration, I think. I'm looking for the list here. And he's also taught as an adjunct professor. So please, Butch.
Okay, thank you.
Excuse me.
Do we have it?
We need his slides.
I don't have the adapter and I can't put it on this computer.
Oh. Can you speak without your slides?
Yeah, I can speak without my slides.
Okay.
The pictures are much prettier if you
could see them. No chance for okay. As Stu said, my... Is it on?
It's on. It's recording.
Oh, okay. Well, as Stu said, my name is Butch Bosin. My given name is Morris Bosin, but I've been known as Butch all my life, probably because when I was young, I needed a haircut, and my brother named me that. So what I'm going to talk to you today about is my version of requisite variety. The idea of requisite variety is seems very abstract to you, but one way to put it is that you're trying to manage a problem. And I'm going to focus on a couple of federal agencies, the programs. One is the Food and Drug Administration's drug review process. I spent about 25 years with FDA, but the other one that I spent about 6 years with was the Bureau of Indian Education. And I'm going to use those two as examples of federal agencies that have tried to establish a management mechanism. I know the name of this panel is regulation, but if you use regulation in the broad sense, it's how do you manage a situation. And both of these programs manage very complex situations in the outside world. So requisite variety is simply saying how can a federal program, in this case, establish a management approach to address the complexities of the problems that they face without making it too complex? If you make it too complex, you can't manage your own approach. And without making it too simple, because if you make it too simple, you're not going to respond to the problem. So that's a... I was talking with my son last week, who lives in Chesapeake, Virginia, and I said, Kevin, I'm going to give a talk next week on requisite variety. And he says, well, what the heck is requisite variety? I said, let me see if I can explain it to you. It's you want to manage something that it's not too complex that you can't control your own management and not too simple that you're not responding to the problem. He says, well, let me see if I can explain it in my own terms. He said, I'm a backpacker, as you know, and this winter I'm scheduled to go on a 10-mile hike along the Appalachian Trail in Virginia. And if I'm understanding what you're saying, I need to put in my backpack everything conceivable that I could run into while I'm on that trail. And I'm hiking it in December. And so when I was a novice backpacker, I packed absolutely everything into that backpack to make sure that I could survive on the trail. And I went out to the camping store 5 or 10 times, and I finally got everything in it that I thought that I needed for every conceivable possible problem that I could run into. And then I put the backpack on, and I couldn't stand up because it weighed 120 pounds. So then I started taking things out. And I got it very light, but then I realized that all I had packed was a book, a flashlight, and some freeze-dried food. But he said, if I went out like that, I would either get lost, get freeze to death, get eaten by a bear, or go hungry. So my challenge was, how do I pack that backpack in a way that I can deal with the major problems, and then I can still manage the backpack? So then he said, Dad, do I get it? And I said, you got it. So that's the essence of requisite variety. Manage the situation so that you're responding to the problem, but not so simple that you're not responding, and not so complex that you can't control your own management situation. Thank you. I'm through. No, I'm not through. Do you all get that? So when you're looking at, okay, so what are the steps in managing requisite variety? And I boiled it down to three steps: scoping, modeling, and strategizing. Okay, scoping is doing some assessment of how big that problem is. Some of us would call it an environmental assessment. Some of it us would call it just getting out there and acting in the world and seeing just how big and complex the issue is that we're dealing with. And but in some way or another, you have to take a diagnostic of what all is out there that you're facing. So that's scoping. The second step is modeling. So what you're trying to do is, in order to deal with all these complex issues, you have to build some kind of a categorical model, which is a representation of all the complexity out there. It's not the full complexity, but it's a representation. So I'm going to give you another example. If you're a defensive football coach, for those of you who are football fans, and you know the offense is going to run 150 different plays, if you tried to design a defensive positioning for every conceivable offensive play, none of your players will be able to memorize the playbook. So you establish categories of offenses. Like, they might run a two-minute drill kind of offense. They may run a passing kind of offense. They may run a third and long kind of offense. So instead of preparing a defensive posture for every possible offensive play, you design categories of defenses to take care of a number of different kinds of offenses. That's another example of requisite variety. In the case of now that's the simple explanation for requisite variety, but when you're dealing with federal programs, there are other factors that come into, and I think, Phil, you mentioned one too. One of them is that when you're designing a program like drug review or Indian education or environmental protection, et cetera, you're dealing with 360 degrees of stakeholders. You're not the one, if you're the head of the drug review office, you're not the one that's managing drug reviews alone, because you have Congress, you have other agents in the executive branch, you have the pharmaceutical industry, you have the recipient of the drugs, you have citizens who may experience unanticipated consequences. In the case of a Bureau of Indian Education, you have the tribes. So you're dealing, when you're designing a strategy, you have to consider that you have a distributed set of decision makers, and those decision makers have different goals. They may not all agree on the same thing. In the case of Bureau of Indian Education, some participants in that system want to maintain tribal tradition, and others want to have tribal youth socialized into the larger society. So right off the get-go, if you're trying to design an educational approach for Indian education, you have to consider that you're dealing with stakeholders who have different goals. A second area that complicates the requisite variety problem is that you're dealing with a problem at multiple levels. A technical level, in the case of drugs, you want to find out which molecular entity does what to your human system, but you're also dealing with the managerial level, people who have to manage risk against benefit and make decisions, and you have to manage the political level, which means that a prior administration may look with more favor on your regulatory approach than an incoming administration. You have to take that into consideration. And you have to deal at the cultural level, because there can be, in strong culture organizations, there can be major resistance to any strategy that you want to implement. And as an example, within FDA, where I worked, there was a tremendous cultural struggle between the lawyers and the scientists, because the scientists operated out of a paradigm that was probabilistic, that we can't tell you with certainty whether this drug will affect you, but we can give you a probability of it. But the lawyers, who were instrumental in establishing the standards and the regulations, said we need yes or no answers. So there's always a clash between the scientist culture and the lawyer culture. One lives on probabilities, the other lives on a binary system of, you know, either it's against the law or you're within the law. So that's a cultural level. And a third factor that makes it even more complicated is that in some situations, probably most in the federal arena, you're working in a high velocity environment. So things are changing very quickly, and technology is a good example. So taking a step back, if you're trying to establish requisite variety, you want to assess what the whole stakeholder environment is. You want to model it, then you want to strategize. But in order to put down specific strategies, you have to also take into consideration that you have multiple stakeholders who have a skin in the game and who participate in the decision making. You have to deal at multiple levels, technical, managerial, political, and cultural, and you have to aim strategies at a moving target. So I'm just going to briefly talk about FDA and Bureau of Indian Education. FDA, their drug review program, is responsible for reviewing all kinds of categories of drugs. You got it. So you can just skip on. I can just skip on.
Might have to point it back that way. Butch might point it back that way.
We're working on it. He's working on it still. He's still trying to get organized.
All right.
You're getting closer.
Yeah. Okay, there you go. So we've been through that. That's my son. This is the scoping, modeling, strategizing environment. So if you look at on the left-hand side, that's the whole complexity of whatever you're dealing with. What you're trying to do is construct a representation of that universe in categories. And then based on how you perceive the problem through your representation of it, you develop strategies to address each major component. I would add that looking at the whole universe of problems that you're facing and making a representation of that is a completely, almost completely subjective enterprise. So if you have different decision makers looking at the universe and different decision makers looking at the model that's put up there, the fiercest disagreements come in terms of decision makers saying, I don't see the world the way you're seeing it. And I don't see how you're modeling the world the same way that you're seeing it. So that enhances the complexity of the problem. It makes it very messy. This is the three areas that complicate it. A distributed decision-making environment, a multi-level challenge in solving the problem, and you're operating in a high velocity. Stop me anywhere along the way. So this is FDA. They're responsible for reviewing different categories of drugs, investigational drugs, or drugs that have been tested on animals, and they have to submit a preliminary application for review based on whether it killed the animal or not, whether it's safe, and then they have to go through a more intensive new drug application, which is intended to improve safety and efficacy. And they review about 100 to 200 new drug applications annually, over 700 generic drug applications. So although safety and efficacy is their mandate, they're surrounded by the stakeholders that we're talking about, industry, Congress, etc. Bureau of Indian Education, they oversee standards and strategies for about 183 BI, Bureau of Indian Education, known schools and tribal schools, etc. Their challenge is they have to respect the sovereignty of the tribal nations and at the same time work in the best interest of the students in their current life and in their future life. Okay, so this is the FBA model, the drug review model. The way they have constructed it, and you could, again, this is a subjective enterprise, they've constructed their world into investigational new drugs, new molecular entities, which are breakthrough drugs, generic drugs, and non-prescription drugs, which are over-the-counter drugs. So for each of those representations of the complexity, they develop strategy. So for the investigational new drugs, they have a different way to proceed. For new molecular entities, et cetera. So you get the gist of scoping, modeling, and strategizing. So in FDA, think back to the backpack. If they pack everything in their drug standards process, if they try to develop drug standards for every new technology that is coming along the pipe, it would overwhelm their ability to manage their own drug review process, and it would overwhelm industry with huge numbers of regulations. If they try to unpack their backpack only to the bare essentials, they're not being responsive to real needs. And one of the most vivid examples of this, when I was in FDA in the 80s, we were surrounded by AIDS protesters because we did not have a fast track to improve AIDS. We were oversimplifying our management model. So the stakeholders resisted, and we responded by establishing a fast track for AIDS drugs. It's still going on today. Any questions so far? Okay, so this is one of that, and excuse me, I'm running over here. This is an example of one of the complexities that I talked about earlier, multi-level perspectives, technical, managerial, political, and cultural. FDA has a challenge of how do you mesh science risk assessment, cost versus benefit, the political implications of new administrations coming in and overthrowing what was prior administration's view, and the cultural, the one I talked about. If they didn't solve this problem, the impact is slower drug reviews and medications not getting to the people that need them. So that some of their variety-reducing solutions, which have taken a patient, Bob, these are some of the ways that they want to implement to reduce that complexity. One of them is they have advisory committees that are supposedly objective bodies that tend to coalesce the political, the scientific, the managerial in making recommendations to FDA on what they should or shouldn't approve. They establish standard protocols so that even though there's conflicts between scientists and lawyers, standard operating procedures define what the roles of each of those positions are. So it's another way of reducing variety. They instituted user fees for new drugs. User fees, if somebody's paying you to do something, even though there's a lot of disagreement about what you should do, that tends to be a variety reducer because it focuses you on producing a product that you're getting paid for. And when industry started paying to have their drugs reviewed more quickly, that tended to focus all of the different stakeholders in the FDA to come to a timely decision. And the bottom one, I'm sure I'm going to get some disagreement on that, FDA attempts to maintain political neutrality in this whole process. And we can have a debate about that. You're about there?
Yeah. Why don't we take a few questions?
Yeah.
And discussion.
Yeah.
And
can I just do one or two more quick slides? I want to skip to the end. This is Indian education, the same problem that they model the universe. They develop strategies for each one. They have their own over complexities that if there's so many educational standards, it drains and strains school administrators and teachers' capacity to teach. If they oversimplify and impose uniform national standards that are not responding to individual tribal educational needs. Bob, I think this is just an extension or maybe a reinforcement of your list. These are some of the generic types of approaches that federal agencies could use to reduce the variety. One is to form partnerships that create some kind of synergy. This example here is, remember when Tylenol was had the poison problem, private-public sector partnerships got together, the FBI, Johnson & Johnson, and FDA to come up with a solution. Economies of scale would be a way of spreading fixed costs, like sharing laboratory space, or renting educational facilities to spread the fixed costs there. Transferring core competencies, meaning providing guidance to drug manufacturers, and in the case of education, establishing teacher mentor programs. Prioritizing risk, using information technology, which we've probably spent far too much time, but little time talking about, accelerating drug reviews by submitting online applications. You all have heard of the Khan School, facilitating online learning by reversing the sequence so that you absorb content at home and the teacher answers questions during the traditional placement. And improved processing. So some examples of variety of users.
Of the problem is under the control of the observer. Now, there's a lot of discussion in the world today of complexity. And if you listen to the discussion, I think what you'll find is that a lot of people think the complexity is out there. And to some extent, it is. But it's also in the observer. How much of the complexity and what aspects of the complexity are you going to pay attention to? Because if you know the magical number 7 plus or minus 2, it's this notion of limited intellectual capability of human beings. It's very limited. But we somehow get through life by focusing on things that we've been told to focus on or that we might focus on. So we always make those decisions. So always regard complexity as under your control. Because it is, whether you realize it or not. Okay, and if anybody talks about complexity as though it's outside a regulator, it's an epistemological error. Okay.
Carl Weick referred to it as getting out there and enacting in the world. And when you're acting in the world, it's what you're paying attention to that drives what you think is complex or not. If you never pay attention to certain parts of the education problem, drug problem, it's not part of what you see as corruption. So it's not, I'm just reinforcing this, it's not objective.
Okay, great, okay.
Yes. Yes. So how do you balance stakeholder participation as a regulator in an environment where private-public partnerships are becoming increasingly popular as an alternative to government? Historically, there's always been this antithesis between private sector and government, and how had a federal advisory committee act, very concerned about transparency and undue influence of government in terms of making public policy. Now there seems to be a sea change where government and private companies are working together somehow and how to build and better between for profit and public interest.
Well, I think that's there's politics on both sides, so it's a political discussion that's going to get resolved, but it's not going to get resolved by one side or another. It's going to be a dialogue backed by power. Whoever has the most gold wins.
I would argue for mandated transparency.
We have one more speaker, Jixuan. He has great experience in both China and in the United States and in devising educational programs. He's a bit of an entrepreneur, so Jixuan.
Okay, my topic is feasible cost, requisite variety, and preferred taste, the three dimensions of good regulation, highly relevant to the title of our panel. What I'm doing is I'm trying to push the envelope outside a little bit, build up from what the previous two speakers already talked about. So let's give it a try. From a second-order cybernetics perspective, regulation is always with an observer actor defined goal. So without a goal, you don't have any. You don't consider any what kind of a regulation. I put it on type one, type two to distinguish. Type one is to keep a variable within a defined range. Type two is to change a variable to a preset value. It's like you're driving a car from A to B, and it's a process. Okay, both types involves a model of the relevant system. So you have to define your system first. Now, effectiveness, as for a designed intended result, I just want to highlight the role of observer. So you have somebody design or somebody has intended a certain kind of a result. So our topic, effective regulation, it means it needs to be satisfied by the observer or the actor. So good or bad actually is a spectrum. You can have a poor regulation, you can have a so-so regulation, okay regulation, good regulation, better, best, great, ideal. So it's a whole dimension that you can think that where you choose your balance point. So my purpose is that a measurement scale within a thinking framework can be built. And some stimulating example is on that spectrum. We can use an example as simple as a camera. You use a camera to get an image. So what kind of a camera is a good camera? What kind of a image is a good image? And also in management area, what do you mean by a good team? You know, a good organization, and good government, and good society. It's always coming back to who will be do the definition, and based on what kind of a needs, and using what criteria. So that's my proposal, is to come up with a three-dimension criteria instead of just one dimension. Ashby's law of requisite variety pointing at one dimension, which is the variety dimension. But for common people with a common sense, the first question come up before you want to make any decision is about the cost. And sometimes we make a mistake on that. So we do things that cost us too much, that we run into a huge deficit. And the previous two speakers talked about this already. The third one is a preferred taste. I want to explain that more because it's all kind of goes to the direction of what we design and what we dream for. So XYZ, you can use your three fingers to memorize that. The first dimension about, it's the economy, stupid. So economy and the cost and the resources of what you have is always the first consideration. And cybernetic principle of law of recursive variety has been covered by our two previous speakers. The third one is a little bit more subtle. The same point can be presented by a frog, or can be presented by a beauty. We tend to have a preference among the two possibilities. So let me go through them one by one. On the cost axis, it's all about the resource. It's you have an economic limitation there. How do I use the pointer here? Okay. Regulation starts from a perception of a need. Okay, so we need to control, or we need to drive a variable. How much would this cost? A lot of times we forget about this, especially when you have a huge government and you have a lot of disconnections of your consequences or circular causalities. So system tends to behave anti-instinctly. Wait a minute. Once you decided that, this regulation system is affordable by us, we can then start in the designing process and how to implement it. And at that point, law of recursive variety can kick in. And I want to say that some organizations can do more with less. It can use less resource to become more effective. And that is influenced by the culture. So I have this concept of organizational efficiency index, which is one minus organizational friction coefficient. It's a simple introduction, is that you have resources consumed to accomplish actual work, achieving organizational goal. And you have resources consumed for achieving team coordination. You have communication costs there. So if a team keep debating, and like one of you just mentioned, different perspectives keeps arguing with each other, and the actual work got neglected. So you have four types of organization using this criteria. you have a highly efficient one, you have a zero friction inside. And well, half of the energy spent on communication, you have a social organization. And then you have basically four types. Okay. So I'm proposing a law of limited rationality, in a way that you have to pay attention to the long list of cognitive biases and their debate with each other. And a good regulation system, a good regulatory system needs to eliminate those biases as much as possible. But you cannot do this endlessly. I mean, you always have your monetary cost and bio cost, time, attention, stress, health, etc. So you have to stop somewhere. So your rationality actually cannot be ideal. It's always a limited. It's always a compromise you have to make. Requisite variety, okay, this is the original Ashby model, Ashby quote, and I found this one on internet, which improved a little bit by pointing at, making an interesting point that if you are running into a problem that your requisite variety is not enough, then you should have authority to become a self-organizing system in order to generate a controlled response. You have to, you can have that. You can have the whole thing. You don't have to do that. So, this second Y dimension, a lot of literature is available. So it's not my point. But I just want to say that Ashby law is as important as law of gravity. It's strictly enforced whenever you are aware of or not. Now the third one is a little bit subtle. First, this here is example. You want to say, your anti-vax, you know, anti-vax movement. It's so negative, and it's politically incorrect. So this proposal is how about we say pro-disease? But more seriously, examples is the change happened in human history. Abandonment of colonialism. Under what basis it happened? It's not a requisite variety. It's not a cost. It's an evolution of our value system that we know that what we did previously was ugly. So we should stop doing that. Same as the anti-slavery movement. I have noticed that there's a famous list of anti-slavery pioneers, 24 of them. You can find them on the internet. Among them, only two were real black leaders. 22 of them are slave masters. Something changed in their value system in this direction. I mean, in this dimension, preferred taste. So that's my purpose, to bring your attention. Maybe there is a law of a preferred taste. Human beings prefer their more pleasurable, subjectively definable option when other aspects being equal inside their scope of awareness. So coming back to our topic, good here means a point or a range in this 3D coordinate. So this dot is what I mean good. Or it could be a range. So it can be also expressed like, OK, if what we do falls into this area, it's good. If we go outside here, we're in trouble, one way or another. So my purpose is to think in this way and develop the measurement skills that could help policy-making processes. So facing a lot of dilemmas, you have a hard way, easy way, you go to heaven, you go to hell. You have angel and you have devils, you have right decision, wrong decision. So different people, different stakeholders, different participants have a different definition of what a good regulatory system is. So it might be spread like this. This is not very accurate. I just copied it from some internet source to illustrate my idea. So the point is, how do you get a consensus among these different perspectives? So back, X, Y, Z, we want to measure human limitations on three dimensions. The first dimension is organizational efficiency index, or it's all about a cost. The second dimension is about the regulatory capacity. It's the variety wise. The third one, you can see it's a test wise. So putting them all together. On the cost dimension, it's about the limitation on our energy reserve or our resource reserve. It's about our capital, our relationship, guanxi. It's a resource domain that you must make a decision, find the optimized choice. It's about what you have, and sometimes people split on this kind of a perception. Okay. Next one, it's the limitation on cognitive resolution, regulatory capacity. It's an information domain. It's about what you can, and sometimes people split with this kind of perception. I'm smarter than you, things like that. So the third one is about the limitation on desirability. It's an ideal domain that what you dream for. Also, it has a negative tone. Sometimes conflict arises from there. So I'm done. So basically, emphasize three concepts. Affordability, our previous session panel talked about that. Functional capacity is about this law of recursive variety. Desirability sit on the last one. Okay, so that's my purpose, is to trying to bring that over here and to think more three-dimensional instead of one.
Okay, questions for Jixuan.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you for the presentation. I think it's an interesting way to look at the policy analysis. And I just wanted to ask you, just curious to know, so I understand that from this three-dimensional model, you want to illustrate a good sort of range of decision-making, I guess. But then you said something like, so you built this to help policymaking. So in practice, how is this, how do you think this will be helpful for policymaking?
Well, we may write another book. I mean, along the 800 miles of available books for Congress.
That's one way. But more practical way would be with a discussion like this form into some strong opinion that hopefully can be communicated to the policymakers. A lot of people have the wrong perception. If you check internet about the law of the requisite variety, you will be very disappointed that a lot of people missed the mark. There are also people talking about cybernetics to be redefined as some cyborg thing, that they are recommending you to chop up your legs and then install a robotic legs, which give you a lot of advantage over others, things like that. So it's pretty confusing and misleading. So we need a lot more discussion like this.
Jason, going to your third dimension of preference or evolution of values, can you incorporate into your model cyclical as opposed to evolutionary?
Cyclical?
Yeah.
So cycle. That, cyclical.
Yeah. Where tastes or preference, take anti-slavery, in other terms, it seems to be coming back so that it's a cycle rather than evolution, or is that a judgment?
I would prefer a spiral type of thing that's seemingly coming back like this. Okay, this is true. This is true also, but the truth is this thing. And maybe more, if we have more dimension of cognition, it may be even more fancier stuff. But I have a lot of debate with the cyclical view of history, and that I'm a firm supporter of evolution. I think, especially coming back to the point Hans von Forst made about the non-trivial machines. Human complex system has a memory type of thing that it won't completely repeat the past, because you always have some internal status being changed. As long as our memory and our history is there, people learn and to be different, I think.
Mark Twain had a great quote. He said, "History doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes." R-H-Y-M-E.
Rhymes, yeah. Sounds familiar.
Other questions? Discussion?
I don't know about you, but this was very educational to me. You guys introduced a number of considerations that I hadn't thought of.
Could you redefine the requisite?
Yeah, let me go with that again. it's really an extremely simple idea. And it has analogies to the amplification of a force in electric system. You have the variety in the system being regulated, and the variety in a regulator. Take a football game. You got the same number of players on each side, or a basketball game. You assume perfect hostility. Everybody on the other side is out to catch you, right? And so you have to match their moves with your moves, and you have to get around their defense, okay? However, if not everybody is against you, you don't need as many players. Consider a police force. You have about one policeman for every 2,000 citizens on average. Because you don't have to regulate what every citizen is doing all the time. You just regulate the illegal activities. Or, if you amplify the situation a little farther, let's say you're trying to control your economy. You can let Ford and General Motors compete with each other on most things. And all the government does is that imposes restraints on agreements and restraint of trade. So you control antitrust activity, you control labor relations, that kind of, you set the rules of the game, and you let the participants compete with one another. That gives you an amplification of another factor of 1,000. If you count up the number of people in the Federal Trade Commission and the Justice Department, the federal government can regulate by about 1,000,000 to 1. Now, if you want to go up to the world, how are you going to control the world? You have to change the perception of the game. So we went through a change in the colonial period, in the anti-slavery period. One of the examples that I've used is we used to have ideological competition between the United States and the Soviet Union. And there's remnants of that still. But basically, we've changed to a sustainability model where you try to balance the number of people relative to the environment. And the maps of the world change. They used to be the pink areas and the red areas versus the blue areas and the light blue areas. Now we have the green areas, the brown areas, and the blue areas of the water. That's a change in the game, the global game we're playing. And each time you do that, you get an amplification of about a factor of 1,000. You can apply that to the United States, the regulation of the economy. But you might ask yourself, okay, how is Trump going to affect the lives of the people in Cleveland, Ohio? Well, he's not going to do it directly, but maybe if he gets his carrier thing through and so forth. But the point is that if you're regulating something, you have to have ways of getting things done that you don't do yourself. Do that by passing legislation, and then everybody acts in accord with the legislation, most of the time, okay? And then you find out, oh, there's some effects that we didn't anticipate. So you change the legislation. So that's what we're trying to deal with here, and that is, how do you regulate a really complicated system? And the tremendous advantage that you have is that you can define the system. You can decide what to pay attention to. You can match your capabilities with what you're trying to achieve. And if you're clever about that, you can get amplifications of regulatory capability at many scales. That's what the law of requisite variety is about, is that you have to match the variety of the regulator with the variety of the system being regulated. But you define the system. And that's where the enormous amplification comes from. Everybody knows this, but our language is an obstacle. If we change our language just a little bit, we would see these things. Thank you very much for your presentations and for your participation. I've learned a lot from this. Yes? No? Okay, let's stand.